So we've got a great crowd in here. I see the Complete Energy Services Group is here today. Tony, thanks for showing up. So a couple minutes, come on down. And Hospitality Mutual's in the house today. All right, this is probably one of my favorite things that we do here, and we do some really, really cool things at the food show. Kari Underly's been coming out for the last 3 years. She's a master butcher. She's the founder of Range Meat Academy, and she's got an online training certification class. We're talking to her about probably baking the whole butchery thing into our certified apprenticeship program, because this is a skill that we have to continue to work with, right? If you've got a restaurant and you're looking for your menu, you're looking for cuts of meat that are more accessible, more cost-friendly, this is the woman that can do it. She's Sam Augustine's up there to her from PA Beef, and she's going to help her moderate the show today. But I'm going to turn it over to you, Kari. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you. Right. Am I on here? Can we hear? All right. Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for having me out. This is our third time. So it's really glad to kind of be back in person again. I know we were here last year after COVID. It's really great to see everything expand even a little bit bigger and better this year. I do want to thank the Beef Checkoff, this promotion. This training demonstration is provided by America's cattle producers. So every time a cow is sold, a dollar goes in a bucket, and it works on promotion, education. What else? Education, promotion. Those are kind of the two big ones. And we were also going to Pineland. Where are you guys? Here we go. So Pineland Farms. Do I have that right? All right. Pineland Farms up in Maine. They have so graciously donated the beef for our demonstration. So if you're curious about genetics, where this beef came from, feel free to stop by their booth and give them a little shout out and see what we can muster up here. So what we're going to do today is we're going to talk about one cut of beef primarily, but we have a few up here. Picanha, picanha, potato, potato. It's a Brazilian cut. It's a Portuguese name, and it is the bicep femoris of the beef animal. Anybody know what the bicep femoris is? It's the hamstring. And what's the hamstring? The hamstring is in our back leg, and it connects up here into the hip. And so what we have here is we have part of the spine. And what you're seeing here in the spine is this groove channel. Excuse me. This is where we have the spinal cord. So the spinal cord has been removed. It is a it's a step for contamination. So we always remove the spinal cord. Does anybody know why the spinal cord is removed? I don't want to be a Debbie Downer, but there's this thing called BSE. And it's not a very pretty name. It's when mad cow was real popular. So all the now, the spinal cords are now removed, and that's what you're seeing in this groove right here. So on a positive note, this is a joint. This is a hip. Right here we have the socket. See how nice and smooth that is? That's where the femur bone connects in here. And see how nice and smooth that is? That is not what my kneecap looks like at all, or my hip joint, let me tell you, because my hip gets a little caught here. So I'm ready for a new one. So what we have here is basically the pelvis or the hip, what's left of the ball and socket. And then we have the bicep femoris, which is part, like I mentioned, of the hamstring, which then connects up into the gluteus medius, or doing the butt. So right here in the backside, okay? And that's what we're at. So we think that maybe this cut is gonna be a little tough. Not so fast. So this is the bone in, and this is the boneless version. So we're going to take a knife here, my boning knife, and I am just going to delicately trace right here, and we're going to stay, and we're going to trace this, and then we're going to run in here. This fat here that's kind of flaky, I'm going to pull this out right here. This is the what's left of the kidney suet. The kidney suet, you see how flaky this is? If this was, this would be good tallow for French fries. If, I'm just gonna mention one word, pork, that's it. That's the last time I'm gonna do that. This would be the fat that we would use. What's that fat called? Help me out. Leaf lard. There we go. I was drawing a big blank there. Because I usually don't say that much with beef. All right. So that's the leaf lard. And then we have the, help me out here. What's left of, so I'm going to stay on this bone here. Just give me a second. And we're going to open this up. Now, what happens is when we pull off our sirloin, you'll notice when you buy sirloins, sorry I'm moving around, we have where the carcass was split here, so we have half of the lumbar. So I'm going to stay along the side here. Fighting here. All right. So now, this is our sirloin. Now, have we ever heard of bone-in sirloins where you have a piece of the tenderloin, a big piece of a bone, and the sirloin, the big old-fashioned sirloins. And when you would cut the sirloin, you would be cutting through this portion of the bone. And this bone is going to change. So sometimes you'll get a pin bone, sometimes you'll get a paddle bone or a wedge bone. And where that is coming from is as you cut through here, this bone shape is changing. And that's where all these names come from. So if we left this back on, cut this straight across, we'd actually have a piece of the tenderloin right here on the sirloin. So in a human, so we're going to, oh, I'm going to come back to this. So when we take off the New York strip right here, and you get this cut called a vein steak or an end cut, where it's coming from is this back portion here where it connects to the sirloin. And you're starting to see a little piece of this part of the sirloin right here, and this is where it makes that cut. So when you're seeing a couple different muscles on a New York strip, you're actually picking up a portion of the sirloin, and this is why, because it breaks right here. So this is going to be our pelvis, our hip. You could come in here and trace some of this out, but in lieu of time, we are not going to do that. So I'll let you decide how you want to. I think it's going to fall off. It's going to fall off. Okay. Now, these top sirloins we can get pretty frequently. This is really nice beef. This is hormone-free, grass, pasture-raised, corn-finished, or carbohydrate-finished. And we're going to pull off this fat here. I'm going to keep this fat on a pile just so we can see what we're doing with. And now, if I cut my sirloin steak, which I'm going to do over here, that fat is really slippery. So I'm just going to do a face cut. It's not going to be a pretty cut, but we're going to see what we get here, okay? So I'm going to come right through here. Okay. So this is a traditional sirloin steak. Now, when I cut this, I'm actually cutting with the grain on this top piece right here called the top sirloin cap, or the culotte, which is for underwear, okay, which is a wrap around, or a skirt, this is a French name, or in Brazil, Portuguese, it's picanha, picanha, picanha. How do you guys say it? Picanha? All right. It's one of those things, tomato, tomato. It's like, oh my gosh, I'm going to talk about it. I better make sure I get it correct. So anyway, but when we cut the traditional steak this way, we're actually cutting this portion of the sirloin with the grain. And we want to make sure that, first of all, how many portions is this? One. I knew that was coming, right? One, two, three, four, five. 4 ounces raw, 3 ounces cooked is a portion. So we've got a lot going on here. So what we're going to do is I am going to pull this top sirloin cap right off. And these top sirloins, you can purchase whole like this. You can purchase them without the cap already removed. It really depends on what you would like to do. So we're going to take that cap off. And now, this whole piece is what we would, a delicacy in Brazil, and they would save these. Now, do we have anybody here that's familiar with this cut from Brazil? It's actually longer. It's actually longer. And the reason why is this is connect, right here is where we cut off from the bottom round. Okay, so the whole round or the leg that we're familiar with. And we actually clip this portion of the sirloin the way we break the round. If we would leave this kind of whole, and then you can actually move back the break on the round if we left it in. Okay, I know that's, we're gonna suspend. How can I make that clear? That was clear as mud, huh? So pretend this is the bicep. This is the part that's up here in my butt, right? It's coming up in here, and it continues down my leg. Okay, or the cow's leg, a quadruped. It goes down the leg. It actually comes about this far. And in Brazil, it'll be a lot longer. So when you buy a bottom round, there's going to be a point to that bottom round. That piece is just like this, and it can be used as a top sirloin cap. It's the exact same muscle. It's from the same location. It's just how we break things a little different. So if we have any people that are bringing in hindquarters or whole animal, this is something that you should take a look at because we can get a bigger cap. So I am just going to trim this up because that's what I do. I like to cut meat. So this would be ground, and this would go into my ground chuck. No, this one's going to go into my ground sirloin. We want to make sure we don't have any little pieces of bone in here. So this would be our ground sirloin trim. Or if we were gonna put our trimmings together with other pieces, it would be called ground beef, okay? So very important if you're gonna merchandise. I am gonna pull a little bit of this nice fat off. It's nice color, I like it. All right. Now, you can leave this whole, which I would 100% recommend, is we're gonna leave this whole. Throw out that fat unless somebody wanted it. I am gonna take off this fat right off the top, and we're gonna expose this little bit of connective tissue right here on the top. And that connective tissue that's on the top is really, when we think about meat that's tough, we're really thinking about, this is our little trim. Nice, nicely done. We're really talking about breaking down not so much the muscle, but the connective tissue. So pretend I have a thing of spaghetti. Let's pretend this is spaghetti. And what's holding this spaghetti together is connective tissue. So what we're trying to do is break down that connective tissue so the bite is a lot tender. Okay, so this is my makeshift spaghetti here. It just happened to work out that way. And what it is this connective tissue that's very tough. So that's gonna have a hard time breaking down, especially if we're doing a high cook heat, which I would recommend. We're gonna either sear this or put it in the oven and then finish it up on the top there and give it a nice sear, or we're gonna slow cook it. And so because I would like this to have a nice slice to it after I'm done with the cooking process, I just take off a little bit of this connective tissue here so we have a nice lean piece. Because that's the part, if I leave that on and somebody bites into that, it's gonna give them a little bit of a chew. So you'll be able to see this connective tissue. If you're gonna grind this, it's gonna get a little tough. So you would want to take off your lean, and then that would be just part of our connective tissue, and I'll put that there. Okay, so we're going to leave all this fat on here. We could trim it off if we'd like, which I'm just going to take a little bit off the top just to give it that nice, pretty color. It's getting a little warm here. So we're gonna leave this one whole. And we are gonna grill this. We would grill this indirect on the grill. We're gonna let this fat just drip into the meat, and then we're gonna slice it across the grain. Now remember, this one is like if we cut it this way, is the way we had it here on our steak. When we roast this, we're gonna make sure that we come to the point. Now, something that gets a little confused around this parts of the country, this is not a tri-tip. This is a top sirloin cap, a culotte, or the picanha. The tri-tip is part of the bottom sirloin, okay? The bottom sirloin, if I had my picture of my cow, is more in this area instead of back here, okay? I'm gonna leave this piece of fat on here. We can turn these into some center cut steaks. I'm gonna pull this connective tissue, you'll see here, off. This is gonna turn into our stir fry, or what I like to call, I'll do it on the other one, our top sirloin skirt. This is gonna be stir fry. We could trim this up for kebabs. But I also like to call this, and I'll do it with this other one too and show it right now a little bit better. A little more stew. This is what I call the top sirloin skirt steak. So if you are cutting this at the shop or at home, This is the top sirloin skirt. You're not going to find this when you call your purveyor. You're not going to find this when you call your local processor, because they're going to look at me like, what is that Kari girl telling you? Again, she's lost her mind one more time. So, top sirloin skirt steak. I am going to show you again where I cut that from. I'm going to grab this top sirloin. We're going to trim off this fat on the top. And I am going to... It's this piece right here on the top. I'm going to be a little more delicate with it so you can see where this piece is coming from. So this would be something that I would throw in with my skirt steaks. So if I was marinating some inside or outside skirt steaks and I had this in my bag, I would throw this in here. And this is what's on the top. This piece right here. So I'm going to come and grab it. Sorry, I'm kind of getting in my... Okay. Now, this stuff right here is what sticks to that bone. So when I was pulling this off of the hip there, the pelvis, this sticks to the meat. So whenever you see this heavy, heavy orange connective tissue, again, that's something that we would need to remove during the meat cutting process. One, it's going to get in the grinder. It's not going to be good hamburger. It's going to mush up. It's just not going to be a good adventure there. So we want to make sure we take that off. You will see that a lot on the flat iron steak. You'll see that periosteum, which is what sticks the muscle to the bone. Go ahead and just save a little bit of this trim. So we are donating some of this meat here. So trying to save what I can. Here. How are we doing on time? I got 10 more minutes? All right. Okay, back to our culotte. Now you're going to notice this one's a little smaller because I did take the steak off to show you that example, so it's a little smaller, and the break's just slightly different. Again, we're going to take off this heavy connective tissue right off the top. And then, where you'll recognize this cut is now I am going to cut with the grain.
So Kari and Ashley, just so you know, you've got a little bit of runway, more than 10 minutes, so you can, I don't want you rushing through to try to hit that time. You can go a little bit longer than that.
The runway, all right. Thank you. So now, these might look a little more familiar. These you'll see a lot at the, you know, where you have the steak or the thing is blue. No, blue. Green, feed me. Red, stop. I guess blue, I'm in the middle. So This is where you'll see this a lot of times on the advertisement for those type of restaurants. So we're going to go ahead and just make a few more of those. I'm going to trim my steak. When you trim your steak, you want to go straight down, and then you can kind of bevel on the inside. And what that does is that's the old meat cutter's trick, because it makes this look like it's a quarter inch, but there's actually more fat in the middle, so I'm selling you a little more fat. Sorry, it's in my jeans. Literally, my grandmothers were butchers, literally, both of them. My grandfather was a butcher, my dad was a butcher. And I was like, there's no way I'm doing this. There's no way. Sure enough, you know, I really fell in love with the grounding part of the trade. And when I apprenticed for 3 years, and it's hard to find those apprenticeships now. And that's why we created the Range Meat Academy, which is an online vocational trade school. We are headquartered in Chicago, so we're approved by the Illinois Board of Higher Education to operate as a vocational trade school. And we'll just leave that one here. Let's do it like, yeah, nice. All right, so now I am gonna trim off this bit of fat here. So why an online trade school? Can you learn how to cut meat watching videos online? Yes and no, right? We've kind of lost the ability to train this trade. One, it's expensive. One, we're losing the ability to pass it down. I am gonna take this top sirloin. We could make a few nice steaks. I'm gonna cut this one lobe off this section, and now I'm gonna use this piece, and we're gonna cut some nice sirloin center steaks off the side. So now we're gonna have about a good inch thick. I can use my knife is a good measure for about an inch. So if you're looking to figure out how to do that, just kind of measure up your knife, pull it through. This would be a kind of what sometimes we would call a butt steak. I'm just trimming this up, and we're just going to make some kebabs here. I think you kind of get the kebab thing, right? So we'll do some kebabs. And then our nice sirloin steaks. Now you'll notice one thing that I love about the sirloin steak is it's got this amazing beef flavor. Great beef flavor. But it is a cut that I do not recommend overcooking. So if somebody wants to order a steak and they're ordering their sirloin well done, they might have a, hopefully they know what they're getting into when they buy that, okay? Or their menu, because it can get a little tough. So if it is something, you could do a couple things. This could, if you have a nice quality grade, let's say prime or high choice, you could put a flavor rub or marinade on the cut. You would not need anything that's enzymatic or tenderizing. If it's, let's say, grass-fed or select or low choice, then you may want to add some tenderizing marinade to that. So this would be a nice little roast. We're gonna see if I can cut through here. And then these are our sirloin fillets. So, can you learn how to cut meat online? Like I said, yes and no. If you can get through the training and you're still into it, it's a nice way to get people in the game already ready, you know. So that way when they do come for their hands-on training, they have already learned the basics, and then we can jump right in to the knife work instead of having to take the time while they're at the table to explain some of the butt and the seat work. All right, we have one more sirloin here, and basically we are going to turn this sirloin into whatever we want. We could leave this as a whole roast. This is the one here. We have to make sure we cut in the front, and we're going to take out our kebabs in the middle here. So, you know, this top sirloin is pretty versatile. We can get a lot of different cuts out of here. You know, if it's something where you're in a smaller restaurant and you're looking, this is our top sirloin steak. One thing about rosewood handled knives is they get a little slippery, so you want to make sure you keep your hands. Top sirloin. And I am going to turn this into a nice roast. I'm going to tie it though. So this side here, there's two lobes here. I don't know if you can pick this up, but there's this line right here. So if you're doing this back at the shop and you're looking, how did she get that nice round piece for the fillets? That's what you're looking for. You're going to come on the side. And it does open up this piece right here. That's one way that you know you've hit it. So if I don't tie them, I'm going to cut them a little thicker so they maintain some more of that shape. But it's not as round if I don't tie it, so you can see the difference. So that's why tying them or netting them helps keep that shape. So that's where, you know, when we look at it as what we call a fillet, we think of that fillet as being kind of the beef tenderloin, where it's that nice round circular shape. That's what happens when we tie them. It gives you that more visual appeal of a sirloin, a fillet, excuse me. All right. Oh, I thought I heard somebody back there. All right, we're gonna give this a tie one last time. Okay. I have the string. My dominant hand, I do a loop, I pull it through. I think I missed my connection there. Oh, I still have it. A little bit different. This is definitely a butcher's knot versus the loop that you'll see. What's nice about it is you can cut in between the strings versus if you do the loop kind of knot where you loop it, then loop it, and it keeps it in one piece. When you cut that string, then you'll lose the integrity of all your tying. That was kind of a nice little sound effect there. And we're just gonna keep. Now, what's really great also about the sirloin is we talked about the great beefy flavor. It's lean, even extra lean, depending on how much fat you leave on. And it just, the juice is just too strong for my string. So string walks into a bar and he sits down and he tries to have a bar. He tries to have a beer. The bartender says, "I'm sorry, string, we don't serve your kind. You got to get out." So the string leaves the bar. He's a little dejected, and he thinks and thinks, and he's all upset. He's got his hands in his head, scratching his head, and he comes back in, and the bartender says, "Sir, I told you we don't serve your kind. Strings." He says, "I'm not a string. I'm afraid not." Sorry. Okay. All right, that's my last butcher joke. Now we have a beautiful sirloin tide roast. We can cut in between for steaks or leave it whole. It's just wonderful. When you slice it, it's going to have a lot of wonderful juices. Let it rest. Let it sit. It's very flavorful. It's just going to explode when you bite into it. It's just a really great, great steak. Excuse me, a roast. So that's our petite sirloin roast. So you can see that just from a basic top sirloin, we can get a lot of versatility. There's a lot more cuts we can get from the sirloin primal, but the main thing is diversity. What am I saying?
Lots of stuff.
Lots of stuff. There we go. We got lots of stuff up here. So please come up, take a picture. You do have a card on the table, on your chairs. If you would take a scan and fill that out, I think you can get a chance to win some great beef swag. If you want to learn more about this beautiful beef we have up here, local to the East Coast, up and down the shore here, like I said, no antibiotics, no hormones, pasture raised, carbohydrate finished. Go talk to our guys over there.
Hey, Chef, before you run.
Yes, sir.
A couple things. First of all, if anybody's got any questions, get your hand up.
Oh, yeah, please.
And lastly, what do they say? Don't try this at home. I mean, she was like, well, that knife was flying around like a ninja, and we don't want anybody going to the hospital by taking this and going home today and trying on for size. She's a professional.
Yeah, my insurance doesn't cover the at-home program, so.
Does anybody have any questions for Chef?
Anything.
Hold on.
Come on, somebody's got a question.
Chef, what was the name of the online educational program again?
Yes, you can Google Range Meat Academy, and we have two curriculums, and it's from like the basics, like what's a steak, what's a cow, and all the way up to cutter. We cover pork, lamb, and beef. So all the way from sides to individual cuts. So
thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for the question.
Any other questions? All right, well, listen, we are blessed to have Kari and Sam out here on an annual basis, because this is just stuff you don't get to see every day. So, Chef, thank you very much.
Thank
Sam,
you.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you. Go Beef!